وللرجال عليهن درجة.
First thing first. When you look at this ayah, you find it mentioned in the middle within a very specific context, and that is divorce. This ayah is beautiful, absolutely beautiful. And before I go any further about it, let me reiterate that. Islam is a universal religion, not local. Islam is not for Saudi Arabia, and it's not for Baghdad, and it's not for Damascus. It's not for any one's place. It is a universal religion. It's the last one sent to mankind, and it is boundless, timeless, and free, applicable anywhere on earth, anyhow, anyone, with anyone. You must, my dear brothers and my sisters, from now on, change your perception and look at al-Islam as a universal religion. Look at it with the eyes of international, not with the eyes of local. Number two, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew how humanity would amount to, how we humans would become after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah knows the future. If Allah wanted to legislate something for mankind until the last day, He would have done it at the time of Rasulullah. If there is no clear text in the Quran or in the authentic ahadith that do not contradict Al-Quran, then that's that, because our Islam has become a very troublesome religion, a very headache religion, because men of religion took it upon themselves to allow and not allow a lot of things. So we must understand that anything that Allah has prohibited or allowed in the time of Rasulullah ﷺ is that. Anyone that comes after that is bound to provide an evidence from Al-Quran or the authentic Sunnah that is working hand in hand with Al-Quran. No more that the scholars agreed unanimously without them having a Quran and a Hadith. This must stop. Number three, Islam is not specifically designed for men and women. Both, when Allah spoke about Islam, He spoke to one, and that one is the son of Adam. It means man and women. End of it. Kaput. Stop it. Close it. End of it. There is not a woman should put her hand somewhere in a salat and man should put it elsewhere, because Allah didn't say it in the Quran and there is no mention of it in the Hadith. This is the sayings of men of religion, men who have taken Islam in their hands to control us. Therefore, many husbands, due to wrong preachings, believe and worst always assume that they are preferred over their wives and that they possess a divine immunity which gives them the ultimate powers over women in general and wives in particular. And because of this ill understanding, it has become ingrinding into their minds that the wife must beautify herself for him. She must nurse him. She must always make him happy. She must dance to his tunes. She must always be available to his commands and to his anytime he wants her, because it comes from the ill belief that woman is here to serve man, the ultimate gender on earth. The thinking that men are over women by a degree because of the gender has created a lot of problems. The man must be served at any time. The woman, you must serve him tirelessly. You must keep him happy at all times. You mustn't fall sick, nor refuse his wishes and desires. And when you are in bed with him, you better scream his name. Otherwise, you are doomed to punishment of Allah. All these things come from an ill understanding. And it is enough for us that Allah married his prophet to 9 women. You see, one of the wisdoms of marrying 9 women is that Allah tells us that women are different. And here is one man that deals with maybe 9 types of women. Psychological, sexual, emotional. Women have different needs. So here is a man that dealt with 9 different types of women. And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was the best husband to them all. And they were the best wives to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And guess what? He never was threatened by any of them in his malehood. He never told them, I am superior than you, even though he was the prophet. Perhaps in that we should learn a lot. The degree of man over women is really scary. Because him being superior, you must accept his mother and live with it if he doesn't like your mother. Because his mother to him is of a great deal. But your mother is a second, third great deal because you are not that great in his eyes. And even if you are not in a sexual state, you must respond to his call. Even if you are busy cooking, washing, or even attending some of your own business. Your private parts, my sister, do not belong to you. They belong to him. Is when he wants them. Do you think for the love of Allah that Allah will send a messenger with such teachings? As I said earlier on, Allah knows his creation. Allah knows that we men, we don't need any emotions attached to having sex. We are visual creatures. That's it. We see a woman beautiful. That's it. It goes through all our wires and there you go. But to a woman, she needs warming up. She needs seduction. She needs all these things. You cannot just spread a woman and jump on her and expect her emotional state to be good or to be acceptable. This is not what Allah would legislate. But you've got some people that would say, even if you are cooking, if he comes home and he's got his mind set on sex, you better obey to his, come here. This is the problem with when man understands that his gender is far higher than that of woman. So where in the universe of Islam today do women fit? Where? Is this what Al-Islam came with? By Allah, it is not. And instead of educating men about sexuality, and I will do it in this series of stigmas, guess what? They don't at all educate nothing. It's the biggest taboo about sexuality here. They never explain to a man that there are times of what they call here the unplanned sex, or what they call them here in the West, quickies. Well, sometimes you don't want to go for the whole shebang of the sexual performance and romance, all that kind of stuff. And when both couples are happy with it, hey, go for it. But your woman is not. I will repeat it. Even though they will tell you a hadith here, I will come on to this issue here of the hadith and the misuse and the misunderstandings and the culture and all these things. I will come to these things here. But for today, my sister, learn and know that your private parts belong to you. And you have a right to say within your own right, no. You could be sick, you could be tired, you could be not in completely in the mood or whatever it is. The man should not be threatened by you saying no. This is the attitude of people, the needy, the clingy. They always people, they look for validation and always looking for a yes. That ayah that I just mentioned, وَلِلْرِجَالِ عَلَيْهِنَّ دَرَجَةً, wasn't by itself. It actually is part of in the Surah Al-Baqarah. This is the second surah after Al-Fatiha in ayah 228, again in the context of divorce. But Allah says something peculiar, something that they always cut when they want to push that the superiority of the male gender. And that is, وَلَهُنَّ مِثْلُ الَّذِي عَلَيْهِنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. In the nearest translation, what is the general meaning, and is to them, i.e. to the women, is the same of that which is expected of them or that which is required of them within reason. They say the woman must beautify herself in front of her husband. She must not wear high heels except in the house to beautify her. It makes me laugh. I'm sorry for this. So what does the man do? Just sit on a couch and open his body like this and just watch the woman parade in front of him? Well, actually, Islam says no. It's a 50-50. What you want from her, you got to give it to her. How many times have you seen your husband beautifying himself to you purposefully just to please you? Or is it more, you accept me as I am, but you got to wear the best lingerie and dress in the best things and that's it, it's my world? That is where the sick thinking. And why I say sick thinking, because sickness is always due to a virus. See how tiny the virus is? But you can see how he can bring a whole complete body down. Then the sickness here is a virus somewhere planted. And it needs to go. Yes, it will take generations to go, but if you start educating your children properly, and then suddenly, slowly, slowly, things will start changing. But we gotta start somewhere, and I pray to Allah that this talk today is your first step forward.
To wrap up this pep talk, my dear sisters and my brothers, I wanna say a few things where you have been wronged, and it's time to move forward and really stop this troublesome wrongness. It is very ironic to tell the world that Islam came to free women from whatever they were trapped in. Yet in the name of Islam, new prisons are created for whoever dares to enter Islam. Many Muslim women today are living in an unbelievable big man-made jail full of dogma Islamic teachings, or what I call it is the Guantanamo Bay called the Muslim marriage. Where as soon as you become part of a couple, you must surrender everything that Allah has given you as a human equal being to a man who will consider you as his. And if you care to discuss or challenge some of his decision or some of his sayings or some of his Islamic things, he will throw at your face or in your face many hadith, and you must accept them unquestionably, or you will go to hellfire for a long, long time. After all, my sister, your intellect is lacking and you are deficient in your mind and in your religion. How can you be a full human being to take responsibility of understanding of Islam? You must take the laws and you must keep quiet. Otherwise, it's hellfire. Strangely, I find it really strange that someone opens his mouth or her mouth or writes a book or an article on the internet, claims Islam came to free women, and then in the name of Islam goes and actually enslaves women to no end. Look at the world today. Women around the world are happier than our women today. Wallahi al-Azim, so many times ladies call me with their problems, family problems, and I cannot believe the way men behave. I will mention now about 25 points, and I really didn't want to go further than that, of some laws that are being implemented today in the name of Islam. It's not Islam, it's in the name of Islam, and this is where the stigma series will enlighten you, inshallah, on these topics. But this is pretty much what is written in our books of fiqh, the legacy, what we have got there, the stigma. And this is the dogmas that are thrown at you. You must take them as absolute realities, from covering your face with a niqab, that if you don't do it, then you are cursed or whatever it is, to far worse than that and far less worse than that. 25 points, I will mention them to you now, and believe me, many of them are untrue, if not all of them. The very first one is that the male gender is higher in status than that of the female. And I've already covered this. And you can see it and you can feel it. Number two, female slaves must not wear hijab. Yes. Remember when we said Islam came to set women free? But actually, we didn't tell the full truth. We should have said Islam came to set free women freer and the slave women a little bit less slaver. But actually, in Islam, in our Islamic law, a slave woman must not. It's not like she cannot. She must not wear the hijab. Number three, female slaves must protect only that is between her belly button and her knees. And this is in our fiqh, and the latest one to give this fatwa, Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen, alayhi rahmatullah. A slave girl is to pray with her breasts showing. Some of the stuff that I'm going to tell you today will shock you, but they are in our fiqh, and that's how our fiqh rolls. Okay? So, again, the female slave cannot pray covered with her hair. Everything, her chest must show. Also, when female slaves are sold, they are naked or half nude. Half nude, by that, they threw a towel around the between the navel to her knees, and the buyer can, and I will repeat, the male buyer can open the towel and look at her private parts or her back before buying her. All this is permitted. Because why? She's a slave. It don't matter if she's Muslim or not, believed or not. It doesn't matter if she says, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. But as soon as she is a slave, that's her treatment. Women, once married, are treated like prisoners of war. And this always is, you find that. And as prisoners of war, what they mean by that is that the man has to feed you, shelter you, and clothe you. Anything else
is a good deed of his deed. Number six, the wife is a beatable human. I will come in this in the relevant talks, and you will see more about these topics. Number seven, a woman cannot run her own affairs, including her own inheritance. Yes, you can inherit, but once you inherit, you cannot run your own inheritance. You can't spend as much as you want, and this is called haqqul wilaya. What that means really is your ability to run your own affairs. You've got no right to that. Number eight, you are a source of temptation, sexual problems, my sister. You are seduction, and you are devilish in your own, the way you are and the way you behave. This is why some scholars these days have forbidden for the female to go on the internet by herself and not to check email. Email for you is not permitted, because where are you going to get that email? Number nine, a father can give the hand of his daughter who has not reached the age of puberty and marry her to anyone he wishes without her consent or the consent of her mother. I.e., I can, my daughter is 10 years old. If I see someone that I like, I can give her to him in marriage, and that's that. And this is in our books of fiqh. So it's, I'm not lying to you or saying I'm not against Islam. I'm not against anything. I'm just telling you what the world is seeing when they read, and what's out there on the internet, and why the world doesn't believe us when we say Islam is good for women. Number 10, an adult woman can breastfeed an adult man so to make him a mahram. This is in Bukhari, and this is in Muslim, and it's unbelievable that if a woman sees a man and she wants him to be a mahram, someone where she doesn't cover herself with, like her brother, her things like that, well, she can breastfeed him 5 times until he is fully satisfied. Yes, it is in our fiqh. So many scholars have written about this to defend this argument today, and even go to the extent of saying that anyone who speaks in this issue is a hypocrite, and some of us have deemed other people like myself as a disbeliever, just because this doesn't make no sense. Number 11, in many books of great scholars, a woman is likened to a female lamb, female horse, etc., any female of the animals, because she is ridden, namarkuba, sexually, that is, by a man. Go and figure. As mentioned in Tafsir al-Qurtubi and other books, and I will deal with this later on, insha'Allah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. Number 12, she must not be educated. Some of the scholars today allowed her to reach Quran reading skills, and that's all, i.e. you must keep her ignorant all the time. Number 13, women are deficient in the brain they possess and the religion they follow, purposefully pushed to make you feel, my sister, as a dumb human and a stupid, completely ignorant and completely an idiot, that you are not in full capacity and you are not in full performance. And I've already explained this. Please go on the internet and you will see the true meanings of this hadith. I mean on my YouTube channel. It's called Islam Pep Talk Channel. Also, they equaled you to a black dog and a donkey when it comes to performing a salat. And this hadith, even though reported in Muslim, is absolutely nonsense. Our mother Aisha has refused it, and many scholars have refused it, that you actually are far higher in the sight of Allah than a black dog and a donkey. Even Imam Ahmad alayhi rahmatullah said, for the black dog and the donkey, I understand, but for the woman, there is something in my heart that is not settling well. Yet today they insist on you cutting the salat of a man. And this shows you the perversion of the male gender in the Muslim community. Why is it that a man passes in front of a woman, her salat doesn't cut? Why is that only a woman in front of a man? And you start adding 1 to 2, and it starts making sense to you. They also preach that Ali radiallahu anhu said that a woman is a necessary evil that's needed for a man to empty his desires in. And I greatly, greatly doubt that Ali radiallahu anhu said that. But our scholars in our books of fiqh and our books of heritage, Islamic heritage, this is an authentic statement. Number 16, she gives and is continuously ridden by shaitan because she is an awra. An awra is anything that you don't want people to see. So as soon as the woman walks out of her door, shaitan rides her. This is also in contradiction to a lot of things. I'll cover this in time. Number 17, Women cannot be governor, presidents, prime minister, rulers, queens, and everything. And they can't even be judges if you live in the Middle East, meaning you cannot be in any commander or leadership position. Number 18, when it comes to her marriage, the wali takes over her life. He decides for her and does everything for her. And this is very cultural. Islam has nothing to do with it, as we shall see. Yes, the wali there is, and I will debate the issue in time, inshallah. Number 19, the dua a man makes when he gets married, you know, when they say the sunnah is when you're married, you play two rak'at and then you put the hand on the forehead of the woman and you make a dua. Well, guess what? That is the same dua you make when you buy a camel or a horse. That gives you an idea. Number 20, if she angries her husband, her salat is not accepted. And these are authentic hadith. Everything that I tell you is authentic, and there are some rulings about that. Number 21, if a human was to prostrate to a human, the wife should do it to the husband. Now, the question to ask here is, shouldn't be the kids to their parents? Well, the kids to their parents makes more sense, okay? Shouldn't be the slave to their masters? Why is it the wife to a husband? Total dominance of the male gender. That's the purpose, is the insecurity of the male gender. It's total obedience, or I am not satisfied, or you will go to hellfire for a long, long time. Number 22, if you don't respond to his sexual moves in bed, whenever he comes to you, you will spend the night cursed by angels. Remember, the curse is only on disbelievers and unbelievers. How can we as Muslims be cursed? I'll explain that again in the previous, in next talks, inshallah. Number 23, if a man beats up his wife, you actually cannot ask your husband why you've been beaten up by him. Neither can anyone else. Because even if the judge asks him, why did you beat her up? He will mention this hadith here, authentic hadith, that he cannot ask him to tell him that. Number 24, you can't ask for divorce from that husband even if you are leading a hellfire life. Because if you ask for that and you don't do it whatever according to certain protocols, then it's hellfire for you. Number 25, the last but not the least, scholars said something that is really, really, and I heard it also with my own ears. They say, Allah has mercy on an era where women used to go out three times in their lives, from the womb of her mother to the house of her father, and then from the house of her father to the house of her husband, and from the husband to the graveyard. This is to them the best woman. And the best woman to them is the one who stays home all the time. And the one who performs her salat, not in the living room, not in the kitchen, not, but in her bedroom. And the best place to her bedroom is the corner closest to her bed. This is what they call the pious woman. All this is absolutely garbage. All this is absolutely nonsense. The 25 points that are mentioned, be happy, my sisters, they will all be explained and explained, and you will know that Allah has honored you. You were never meant to be the way they have given you. So they said women before the coming of Islam were, and Islam came and did these 25 points to them. Is this what we are selling to the world? We need to wake up. And in this waking up, inshallah, in the next stigmas, inshallah, series, you will get far more knowledge, bi-idhnillah. That will help you lead a better life, teach your kids on how to be better parents. If it's a boy, you will educate him how to respect his wife. And if it's a woman, you will help her understand how to be a better person for her own self-esteem. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us all get the best of this life. This is, again, your brother, Abdussalam Abu Hanifa. If you want to join my group, please do send me a message on WhatsApp. My telephone number is 0044-78-76-40-8735. Also, this talk will be on YouTube on Islam Pep Talk. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. And I pray to Allah to bless you.